Ancient Egypt. The period of history to which the preceding section is devoted was not an anomaly or a paradox discontinuous with the basic development of history. On the contrary, we have seen an example, perhaps the most striking one, of a style of life typical of the 3rd and 2nd millennia BC in the region that takes in Crete, Greece, Egypt, and Asia Minor. These were the most developed countries of the ancient world. To a great extent, the same tendencies were apparent in the states of the Indus Basin. This epoch marks the rise of a new social structure which was destined to play a decisive role in the future history of mankind, the state. The basic social unit of the earlier period was a settlement around a temple or a village closely tied to territory familiar to the fathers and grandfathers of the inhabitants. All this was now replaced by the state, which frequently united heterogeneous ethnic groups and controlled vast territories, which it constantly strove to increase still further. World empires appeared, pretending to hegemony over the whole world and actually succeeding in gaining control over a considerable part of the civilized world of the time. The first such empire was that of Sargon. Instead of comparatively small groups in which most members knew each other personally, a society appeared for the first time in history that united hundreds of thousands or millions of individuals who were ruled from a single center. This upheaval in the course of history cannot be explained by technological or cultural progress, despite such achievements as the invention of writing, the widespread use of irrigation, the construction of cities, the use of the plow and the potter's wheel, and the systematic use of metals. In spite of these advances, the new epoch was based chiefly on the mass application of the achievements of the Neolithic and Bronze Ages. The force that provoked the changes must be sought elsewhere. It resulted from the uniting of human masses on an unprecedented scale and the subjugation of these masses to the will of a central power. The technology of power and not the technology of production was the foundation upon which the new type of society was based. The state, by means of its bureaucracy of scribes and clerks, took control of the fundamental aspects of economic and spiritual life, justifying this by the idea of the king's absolute power over his subjects and over all sources of income. To illustrate the general tendencies of this epoch, we shall cite some data on two periods in the history of ancient Egypt. The Ancient Kingdom, 1st-6th Dynasties. All land was considered to be the pharaoh's. Part was transferred to temporary individual use, but most of it made up the king's domain, i.e., it was used directly by the state. The peasants were looked upon for the most part as fruit of the earth and were transferred together with land. Acts of transfer typically contain formulations like "the land with men is given," or "land with men and cattle." Peasants worked under the supervision of officials. The officials determined the norms for delivery, calculated anew each year, depending on the harvest and the annual flood. Moreover, the peasants were subjected to obligatory labor, called the hours, for building and other state work, most notably for construction of the pyramids. According to Herodotus, later confirmed by F. Petrie's research, the scale of building was such that to construct the Cheops pyramid, 100,000 men worked for 20 years. The peasants did mandatory work for the king's relatives as well, and for the nobility. All these hours and norms were regulated and recorded in each region by four departments, which were in turn subordinated to the central storehouses and central offices. It seems that the category of agricultural worker, denoted by the word MRT, was especially common. Pharaoh Pepi II decreed the removal of these workers to other regions to provide for the fulfillment of their state duties. According to some sources, these laborers lived in special workers' houses. The crafts were concentrated, for the most part, in state and temple workshops, where the workers were supplied with tools and raw material, while the finished products were turned over to storehouses. Shipbuilders, carpenters, joiners, masons, potters, metal workers, glass and ceramics workers, either worked in palace and temple shops or depended on them for raw materials and orders. Highly skilled artisans with the status of hired free workers were in the minority. A number of important branches of craft production were monopolized by royal and temple workshops. For example, the temples manufactured papyrus for writing material as well as for mats, ropes, footwear and shipbuilding. While Meyer considers it possible that the ancient kingdom had a number of independent artisans and traders, Keyes thinks there was no such category. Trade was exclusively in the form of barter. Gold, copper, and grain were used sometimes as a measure of value, but the entire process of exchange was based on real value. Exchange of this sort is depicted in numerous tomb frescoes. And among the objects donated to the cult for the repose of the dead, none seems to have a monetary character. The famous Palermo stone enumerates the pharaoh's donations to the temples. These include a most diverse list of valuables, including land, people, rations of beer and bread, cattle, and fowl. Officials also were paid in produce. At court they live from the king's table, in the provinces, on the deliveries due to them, in keeping with their rank. Certain persons of high standing received grants of land. But such lands did not form single holdings, with the exception of instances near the end of the period, they were scattered in various parts of the country. The persons to whom lands were assigned had no political rights within these territories. The social structure was built around the bureaucracy. Beginning with the Second Dynasty, an inventory of all property in the state took place every 2 years. It was called the Inventory of Gold and Fields or the Inventory of Large and Small Livestock. To accomplish this task, the king's scribes were sent from house to house, accompanied by a detachment of soldiers. Norms for deliveries and taxes were established on the basis of the inventory. The representatives of central authority in the villages were the village judge and the village scribe. The multitude of titles for the officials is an indication of the degree of bureaucratic control over life: village scribe, village judge, chief of canals, lake scribe, chief of sea construction, the fleet, builder of palaces, overseer of grains and granaries, etc. Beginning with the Fourth Dynasty, the economic life of the country was regulated by two departments, one for fields, the other for personnel. The officials who governed separate regions were not its rulers in the feudal sense. Although they usually came from the aristocracy by birth, and their official title was not infrequently passed from father to son, nevertheless the position of an official was determined not by his birthright but by the king's grace. In other words, by the given official's position in the bureaucratic hierarchy. No one possessed the automatic right to rule by birth. Service began usually in the lower ranks, and a successful official moved from one province to another frequently, without acquiring stable connections anywhere. On official seals, the name of an official was never indicated, only his position and the pharaoh's name. Inscriptions found in tombs make no reference to the social origin of the deceased or even to his father's name, except in the case of princes of the blood. An official's career and material welfare depended entirely on the state as personified by the pharaoh, who could even grant immortality, by allowing construction of a tomb near his own burial place. As Meyer says, quote, Egypt by the time of Mena, creator of a united state comprising Upper and Lower Egypt, was not an aristocratic state but a bureaucratic state. End quote. Furthermore, quote, the ancient kingdom is an extreme example of a centralized absolute monarchy ruled by a bureaucracy that depended only on the royal court and was educated in state schools for the training of officials. End quote. The 18th dynasty, 16th-14th centuries BC. More than a millennium later, we observe a system of economic relations based on almost identical principles. The state, in the person of the pharaoh, owned all sources of income, and anyone making use of them was under his permanent control. Periodic censuses were used to keep track of land, property, occupations, positions. All activity was to be sanctioned by the state. Any change of occupation could take place only with official authorization. With the exception of the priests and the military nobility, the population, both urban and rural, was united into communities or guilds controlled by state officials. Land relations during this epoch were shaped by the recent war for the liberation of the country from the Hyksos invaders. The military nobility, which arose during this struggle, possessed a small portion of the land. Their holdings were passed down, as a rule, by right of primogeniture from father to son, but ultimate control of even these lands belonged to the pharaoh. Thus heirs assumed possession of land only after this was confirmed by the central authorities. With the exception of these lands and the temple lands, other land belonged to the state in the person of the pharaoh and was tilled by peasants under state control. In the tomb of Vizier Rikimura, for example, the agricultural workers are shown along with their wives and children getting sacks of grain and returning empty ones in exchange, under the supervision of an official. The norms for delivery of agricultural goods were determined in advance on the basis of the Nile floods. Cattle breeding was also subordinated to a broad governmental administration headed by the overseer of horned cattle, hoofed and feathered livestock. With the rare exception of individuals in some crafts that required special skill, all artisans were united in guilds and controlled by officials. The heads of agricultural communities and craft workshops were responsible for the timely fulfillment of the plan for state deliveries. If the plan was not carried out, those responsible were punished by being sent to agricultural and construction work. Merchants sent abroad acted as the state's agents. All imports were also controlled by the administration. Often foreign merchants were obliged to deal only with state officials. The administration controlled internal trade as well. All markets were under its supervision. Despite the fact that almost the entire population was to a great extent directly dependent on the state, the society of the time cannot be called either a slave system, as in classical antiquity, or a feudal system. Written records contain numerous terms indicating dependence on the state. I.e., people sent to compulsory work or war prisoners used in building and other state works. However, not one of these terms can be interpreted as slave under the personal control of another individual and employed in economic activity.